A very good morning to all brothers and sisters in the Dharma. Welcome to this morning's Dharma sharing. In about 10 days time, on the 10th of October, it will be the World Mental Health Day. So I would like to take this opportunity to dedicate this talk, dedicate all merits accrued from this talk to all my patients who are on medications, wishing them healthy and happy. Yeah, as mentioned in the introduction earlier, I'm a psychiatrist. So I'm a doctor who specializes in psychological medicine, helping people to treat mental health conditions like anxiety, depression, panic attacks, schizophrenia, and bipolar disorder. Yeah, so in my clinic, when I prescribe medication, I have a middle way approach. So I'm a Buddhist, so also I try to apply the middle way in medicating. So what do I mean by a middle way of medicating? So in my clinic, whoever comes to me, if possible, I will try not to use medication. So that is my principle. Yeah? If the condition is not so severe, I will try not to use medication. I will use non-medication method like counseling, psychotherapy, mindfulness-based therapy, and other methods. I'll try not to use medication. However, sometimes when the condition is a bit severe, I have no choice but to use medication. So I will use medication when needed, and I'll try to use as few medications as possible. I'll try to use the lowest dose as possible. And for the duration of treatment with medication, I will try to use medication for the shortest period as possible. So in today's sharing, I hope none of you need to be on medication. I hope none of you need to be on medication. But if no choice that you have to be on medication, I'll be sharing with you on ways on how to medicate mindfully, how to apply some Buddhist principles as we are taking our medication. Okay, in the Buddhist scriptures, we often find analogies that describe the Buddha as a doctor, the Dharma as a treatment, and all lay people like us as patients. Yeah, this is a common description. Yeah. Have you ever wondered what would the Buddha say whenever you need to take medication? Yeah, I'm sure some of you who are listening to this talk, I'm sure some of you who are on the medication. Have you ever wondered, while you're taking the medication, what would the Buddha say about the medication that we are taking? It's something for us to reflect and to contemplate. Do you think the Buddha will say, no, don't take medication. Medication has a lot of side effects. Don't take medication. Do you think the Buddha will say that? I don't think so. Okay. Do you think the Buddha will say, just meditate, no need to take any medication, just meditate, whatever illness you are on treatment for, diabetes or cancer or mental disorder, no need to take medication, just meditate, everything will well. Do you think the Buddha will say that? I don't think so as well. Okay. Do you think the Buddha will say, life is impermanent, everything is impermanent. You take medication or you don't take medication, you're also going to fall sick, you're also going to die. So no point and no need to take medication. Do you think the Buddha will say that? I don't think so. Then you may be wondering, what would the Buddha say? Yeah, basically, I don't think the Buddha would discourage us from taking medication. So what would the Buddha say? I think the Buddha will say something like this, as mentioned in the Dhammapada verse 204. Okay? In the Dhammapada verse 204, the Buddha says that health is the highest gain, contentment is the greatest wealth. The trustworthy are the best kinsmen, Nibbana is the highest bliss. I'd like to focus on the first two lines, which are relevant to our Dharma discussion today. Health is the greatest gain. Contentment is the greatest wealth. Basically, what Buddha is trying to say is, it's important to stay healthy. It's important to stay healthy physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And most importantly, okay, the Buddha says that health is the greatest gain. Health doesn't come free. In order for us to have a good health, we need to put in effort. it has to be gained. Health doesn't drop from the sky. We need to put in effort to stay healthy. And in order to be stay healthy, of course, we should not be so narrow-minded to believe that medication will cure all illness. We need to have a holistic way of taking care of our health. So besides taking medication, we need to have a healthy lifestyle. We need a diet modification. We need to have a positive mental attitude. We need to meditate, practice the Dharma, and including medication as well. Yeah, so taking medication is one of the holistic, one of the comprehensive ways to take good care of health. Yeah, so the Buddha doesn't discourage us from taking medication. It's okay to take medication when needed together with the other method to maintain our good health. Okay, what else would the Buddha say when we are taking medication? This is something which I reflect again and again whenever I'm taking medication. I also take medication. I take medication for my nose allergy. I have very severe nose allergy. So our medication called Clarinase, which is very good for my nose allergy. I also on and off take medication for my gastric pain. I have a very sensitive stomach. So when I'm taking medication and also when I'm prescribing medication in my clinic, by the way, this is my clinic, I often reflect on this question again and again. What else would the Buddha say about taking medication? Okay. And this reflection, these frequent reflections of what the Buddha would say when we are medicating, the reflection led to a presentation that I made at the Asia Pacific Mindfulness Conference. There was this mindfulness conference which was held in Singapore recently. I was invited to give a speech, a talk, a presentation on a mindful relationship with medicines in healing the mind. In short, it's how to medicate mindfully. Yeah. So today I'll be sharing with some of the things that I presented in the conference and with the extra Buddhist flavor as well, because this is a Buddhist community, Buddhist group. Also, I'll link it more with the Buddha's teaching. So how do we medicate mindfully? Okay, for the benefit of those who are new to the teachings of mindfulness, let me give you an introduction of mindfulness. Mindfulness, or more specifically, right mindfulness, is part of the Noble Eightfold Path. Okay? In Pali, it's called Sati. Sati. Yeah, English translation usually is mindfulness. The original word in the Buddhist teaching in Pali is called Sati. Sati has various interrelated meaning. Okay? Various interrelated meaning. It can mean to remember or to contemplate or to pay attention. They're all interrelated meaning. To remember, to pay attention, or to contemplate. Okay? You might have heard of the word Anapanasati, mindfulness of breathing meditation, Anapanasati. So Anapanasati is remembering to pay attention to the breathing process. Okay? You might have also heard about Maranasati. Maranasati is a contemplation on death. Okay? You have also heard of Buddhanusati. Buddhanusati, which means remembering the virtue or the qualities of the Buddha. Okay, so mindfulness or sati has several meanings. Can mean to remember, to pay attention, or to contemplate. And in the Buddhist teaching, mindfulness is often described, is often taught, described, and practiced together with other Buddhist teachings like kindness and wisdom. Okay. So that is a brief introduction on the meaning of mindfulness. In order to spread the practice of mindfulness for health and healing, I have created a circular mindfulness program known as MINDFULGym. A circular mindfulness program means it's a mindfulness program without the religious component, without any prayer, without any rites and rituals. It's important so that it can be used in a circular way for our multi-ethnic and multi-religious community. So I came up with this mindfulness-based program known as MINDFULGym to help people to reduce stress. And so far, there are more than 10 scientific local research to support the effectiveness of the program for stress reduction in the Malaysian community. Yeah. I'm also grateful to share with you that I managed to get a grant from the Ministry of Health through the Mind Sehat, get to grant sponsorship to run the program free for the community, mindfulness education, free mindfulness education for the community. Yeah, so that's how I apply the principles of mindfulness for general stress reduction. I also use it in my clinic as well. So if you are interested to join the program, today's sharing is not on the MINDFULGym program, but if you're interested, you can actually go to this web page. You can use this QR code, go to the web page, you can access the program online. So recently I conducted the 8-week program on Zoom. It has been downloaded, edited, and uploaded to the MINDFULGym YouTube channel. Yeah. So if you're interested, you can explore on your own. Yeah. In the MINDFULGym program, this is how I define mindfulness. The earlier definition of mindfulness is strictly from the Buddhist perspective. It's from the Buddhist scripture, right? Mindfulness, it means to remember, to contemplate, and to pay attention. Okay. This is the circular definition I use in the MINDFULGym program. So how do I define mindfulness in the MINDFULGym program? Mindfulness is defined as remembering to pay attention to the present moment with an attitude of kindness, a beginner's mind, and wisdom. Yeah, so this is the definition I use. Those who have joined my MINDFULGym program, they will know this by heart. As you can see, embedded in this MINDFULGym's definition of mindfulness, there are 5 components of mindfulness, okay? Representing 5 components of mindfulness represented by 5 R's. 5 components of mindfulness represented by 5 R's. There's the mindfulness memory, mindfulness attention, or more specifically present moment attention, mindfulness kindness, mindfulness beginner's mind, and mindfulness wisdom. So that's how I conceptualize mindfulness in the circular MINDFULGym program. So mindfulness is paying attention. At a basic level, mindfulness is paying attention. Specifically, is paying attention to the present moment. And in the context of what we are discussing this morning, we are talking about mindful medicating. Mindfulness in this context refers to paying attention to the present moment, and the present moment is the medicating experience. Right? Mindfulness is paying attention. It's paying attention to the medicating experience. Not only that, mindfulness, of course, as I mentioned earlier, is paying attention, relating to pay attention to the medicating experience. It's also relating to our medication with an attitude of kindness, beginner's mind, and wisdom. Okay? So this presentation is based on this framework. So mindful medicating is remembering to pay attention to the present moment. In this context, the present moment is the medicating experience with an attitude, a mindset of kindness, beginner's mind, and wisdom. Okay, so that's the introduction. That's the framework. That's the framework that I use for this presentation. Okay, let's go into a little bit more detail on how we can medicate mindfully. Okay, let's start with memory. Okay, in the modern, the contemporary mindfulness world, usually mindfulness is defined as paying attention in the present moment. Present moment awareness, present moment attention, that is the most common definitions of mindfulness used in the modern world. That is not wrong, A less emphasized meaning of mindfulness is actually remembering. Remember, just like I said, that the Pali word for mindfulness is sati. And one of the meaning of sati is to remember, to remind, or to recollect. So how do we apply that in mindful medicating? This is how we can apply it. Okay. At a very basic level, mindful medicating means remembering to take our medication according to the doctor's instructions. Remembering to take our medication according to the doctor's advice. Okay. And very often in my clinic, I'm a psychiatrist. In my clinic, I see a lot of patients with anxiety disorder. So they are very kanjong, they're very worried. And very often, when they're nervous, they cannot remember the instruction to take medication. So usually my advice, very practical advice, I would suggest to them to bring a trusted friend or family member to the clinic to accompany them so they can help to remember the instruction. They help to make notes. Okay? Also, I encourage my patients to take notes. Take notes or ask the friends to come to the clinic to help them to take notes and remember the instructions to take medication. Yeah, so mindful medicating at a very basic level is remembering. Mindfulness is remembering to take medication according to the doctor's instruction. This is a pill box. The pill box can be very useful to minimize our forgetfulness in taking medication. So it's a skillful way to help us to remember to take medication according to the doctor's advice. Yeah, we can also use the mind bell to help us to remember to take our medication. The mind bell is an app. Which functions like an alarm. At a certain interval, it can produce the sound of a bell. Usually, it's used in meditation setting or in mindful breathing setting. So when you hear the sound of the bell, you pause a while to take a mindful breath. So in mindful medicating, we are not using it to remind us to meditate or remind us to take a mindful breath. We are using the mindful bell to remind us to take medication. Yeah. So those are some of the simple ways we can remind ourselves to remember to take medication, the use of the pill box, the use of the mind bell, taking notes in the clinic so they remember the instructions, bring a trusted friend or relative to help to listen to the instructions, to remember the instructions to take medication. Okay, all those are under mindfulness as remembering. Okay, let's go to mindfulness attention. Just now I was talking about mindfulness as memory, mindfulness as remembering. Now I'm gonna talk about mindfulness as attention, mindfulness as a present moment attention. Yeah. In mindful medicating, specifically it means paying attention to the medicating experience. It's not paying attention to the breathing like in Anapanasati, in the mindfulness of breathing. It's paying attention to the breathing process. And in Vipassana meditation, it's paying attention to the rising and falling of the tummy. It's not that. That's not what I mean in this sharing. So in mindful medicating, it's paying attention to the medicating process, paying attention to the pills, the medications. And this is an interesting cartoon with the caption, "Are you mindful or mindful while taking a medication?" That is an interesting cartoon. I think one of the problems in medicating is mindless medicating. What do I mean by mindless medicating? I'm sure some of you had this experience that you forget or you doubt whether you're taking medication. You think, hey, did I take my medicine or I didn't take the medicine? I'm sure those of you who are taking medication, sometimes you have this experience. I have that experience as well. Many of my patients also have that experience. Did I take or I didn't take? Oops, forgot. Yeah. So the one of the ways to prevent that from happening is by the practice of mindful medicating. Yeah. How do we do that? Okay. This is my suggestions on how to medicate mindfully, how to pay attention to the medicating of a process so that we don't forget or we don't doubt whether we have taken or not taken our medication. Yeah. So first of all, I suggest when we are taking our medication, give full attention to the process of medicating. Try to minimize distraction. No TV, no radio. Just pay full attention to the medication. Yeah. Sense the medication resting on your hand. Look at the colors, look at the shapes, feel the swallowing process. Yeah. Give full attention to the entire process of medicating. And mentally, you might want to label mentally as you're taking, as you're consuming the medication. Mentally label, say in your heart, taking medication, I know I'm taking medication. You can either mentally label it or verbalize it. Taking medication, I know I'm taking medication. So this helps us to focus. Okay. And after we swallowed a few, you might want to take a mindful breath. Take a mindful breath, smile. You can also give a smile before and after taking the medication. So it's very simple and practical ways to be mindful when we are medicating. So to pay full attention, that if we do this, we can avoid the problem of mindless medicating, forgetting to take a medication, doubting whether we have taken or not taken our medication. Besides paying attention to the medication process, it's also useful to pay attention to our mindset, our attitude towards medication. In the medical world, there's a thing called the placebo effect or the power to heal. Basically, it means that if you believe the medication works, the medication will have more likely to work. If you believe it works, if your family member believes it works, if your Dharma teacher, your meditation teacher, your doctor, everyone believes that medicine works, it's more likely the medication will work. Okay. On the other hand, there is a thing called the nocebo effect, the power of harm. Okay. If you think the medicine is a poison, you think it will harm you, it's more likely you have side effects and the more likely that it will not be so effective. So it's very important to pay attention to our mindset. I strongly suggest that we change the vocabulary that we use to describe our medication. Yeah. I'm a psychiatrist, so I'll be giving you a few examples. Because I'm a psychiatrist, I'm going to use example on psychiatric medications. But it applies to all other medications as well, like medications for diabetes, high blood pressure, and cholesterol. But because I'm a psychiatrist, I'm going to choose examples related to my field. Okay? I propose that we should call antidepressant as happy pill. We should call antidepressant as a happy pill. Because if we call it antidepressant, it has a negative flavor, you know, antidepressant. So why not we call it happy pill? Right? After all, antidepressant effect is to help to improve our mood. We call it happy pill. For medications for anxiety, for panic attack, for anxiety, maybe we should call it a calming pill. A calming pill. And for antipsychotic medication, antipsychotic medications are used to treat schizophrenia, people with hallucinations, with delusions. Instead of calling it antipsychotic, which is very scary, I'm proposing that we call it a wise pill. Wise pill. That makes sense, isn't it? Because it's used to treat hallucinations and delusion. It distorts our view, distorts our understanding. So after taking it, it treats the hallucination, the delusion, then become wiser. So why not call it a wise pill? So we have a happy pill, we have a calm pill, we have a wise pill. So I often discuss this with my patients in my clinic, you know, so that they have a positive mindset in relating to their medication. I got another point. whatever medications you're taking, I strongly suggest that you try to give it a meaningful name, a positive or meaningful name, so that you have a healthier mindset towards it. Okay, I give you an example. One of the happy pill, the antidepressant, one of the happy pill, the name is called Lexapro. It's called Lexapro. So in my clinic, one of my patients, we call Lexapro a slightly different name. This is a Chinese-speaking patient. We call it Lexampo. Lexampo. The original name is Lexapro. Lexapro. So in Chinese, I call it Lexampo. So it has a positive name. Lek in Chinese, Lek means power or energy. Power or energy. San means Cheng San. Cheng San means vitality. You have the energy, you got the vitality. And Bo is the gem or jewel, like triple gem, Buddhist gem fellowship, triple gem, Zen Po. Yeah. So instead of calling it Lexapro, we call it Lexan Bo. So that can help to cultivate a positive mindset or attitude towards medication. These are the medication envelope. Sometimes in my clinic, when I prescribe medication, on the medication envelope, I put a sticker. I put the MINDFULGym sticker with the lotus smiley with the slogan, be present, be calm, and be grateful. So why I do that? Why am I doing that? I'm doing that to help my patients to have a positive mindset, a positive attitude towards medication. So this is the original envelope. It gives the impression that you're ingesting poison. Okay? Whereas you put a sticker here, it creates a positive, a healthier mindset. Okay, let's move on to the kindness component of mindfulness. So the first part, I talk about mindfulness as memory. Remember to take medication according to doctor's instructions. Then I talk about the mindfulness as attention. Pay full attention to the medication process and pay attention to our mindset in taking medication. Now we're going to move to kindness. So mindfulness is not just paying attention, it's paying kind attention. I repeat, mindfulness is not just paying attention, is pay kind attention. Some people call it kindfulness. Kind attention, kindfulness. What does that mean? It means relating to the experience of medicating with kindness, respect, and gratitude. Relating to the experience of medicating with kindness, respect, and gratitude. So what does that mean? How can we do that? I try to make this sharing as practical as possible instead of just theoretical. Okay? So how do we apply kindness, gratitude, respect in the process of medicating? Okay? One of the ways is by radiating grateful thoughts to everyone who has contributed to the creation of the medication. Yeah. So as we are taking our medication, we can radiate kind thoughts, grateful thoughts to everyone who has contributed to the medication, to creation of the medication. Okay, for example, I will say thank you to the scientists who invented the medicine. I will say thank you to the pharmacies who dispense the medicine, to the doctor who prescribed the medicine. I'll say thank you to my family members who helped me to purchase the medicine. It's just like in our mindful eating practice. So in mindful eating practice, we also radiate kindness and radiate grateful thoughts to everyone who contributed to the food that we are consuming now. So in consuming medication, we do the same thing as well. We radiate kind thoughts, grateful thoughts, loving thoughts, metaful thoughts to everyone who contributed to the medicine that we are taking. Yeah. So mentally try to appreciate all the causes and conditions, all the people, all the things, all the conditions that make the medication available to us. So it's one way to apply kindness in mindful medicating. Okay. Another way This another way is to be kind to our mind and body by humming the Rasa Sayang song and soothing your tummy or heart with your hand. Okay, what do I mean by that? Yeah, this one I have to demonstrate a bit. Okay, so the very often after I've swallowed my medication, yeah, I will soothe my tummy this way. Let me show you. I will soothe my tummy this way. So after taking the medication, I will soothe my tummy this way. I will sing the Rasa Sayang song while radiating loving kindness, while radiating metta to my tummy, to my mind, to my body, and to the medication I've consumed. Yeah. So I will gently massage, soothe my body this way, and I'll sing the Rasa Sayang song. That's how it sounds. Rasa Sayang, hey, Rasa Sayang, Sayang, hey. Hey, may I, may you, may all be happy, happy, happy. May I, may you, may all be happy, happy, happy. Yeah. Okay. So that's how I apply kindness or kindness in the medicating process. Take the medication, massage the tummy, sing the Rasa Sayang song, ready loving kindness. Ready loving kindness to my tummy, ready the kindness to my body, ready loving kindness to the pill I consume, and also the ready loving kindness to all other people who are on the same medication. Okay, so there's a very skillful way to apply kindfulness, apply metta, apply loving kindness in the process of medicating. Okay, if you notice any the tension. I know some of you may have some conflict. You may feel uncomfortable. You may feel certain conflict, or you feel not nice, emotionally uncomfortable when you are taking medication. You can repeat the same process, but instead of soothing your tummy, you can soothe your chest area. Okay. So you can soothe after taking medicine. You can sing Rasa Sayang, hey. Rasa Sayang, Sayang, hey. Hey, may I, may you, may all be happy, happy, happy. Yeah. So same thing as you are gently stroking yourself, comforting yourself, soothing yourself, either the tummy or the heart. So you wish everyone safe, healthy, happy. May my body be healthy, may my mind be healthy, may my body, my mind, and the medications, they befriend one another, may they be peaceful, may they be free from side effects, may everyone in the world who are consuming the same medication, may they be healthy, be happy. Okay, so that's how we apply kindness in the medicating process. Okay, let's move on to beginner's mind. Okay. Being mindful is not just paying kind attention. Of course, there's the kindness part, there's the attention part, but being mindful also means relating to the medication experience with a beginner's mind. Befriending the medication process with a beginner's mind. Okay. What do we mean by that? Beginner's mind means be curious or to have an open mind. Beginner's mind, other words for beginner's mind is to be curious or to have an open mind. So in the medicating experience, basically it means to pay curious attention to the effect of the medication. Whatever medications you are on, whether it's for diabetes, high blood pressure, asthma, high cholesterol, pay curious attention to the effect. Okay, and if you're on psychiatric medication, so I'm a psychiatrist, if you're on medications for psychiatric reasons, then you'll be pay attention to the thoughts, feelings, body sensations, and behavior changes associated with medication. Okay? Pay attention. But most importantly, pay attention with a beginner's mind. Pay non-judgmental attention. Okay, and non-judgmental attention, beginner's mind attention, means to have an open mind. To have an open mind. So how do we apply that? I strongly suggest that if you're on medication, especially you just started taking a medication, a new medication, I strongly suggest that we practice journaling. We have a practice to journal our medication experience with a beginner's mind and an open mind. Take note of the effect of the medication. Okay? The effect of the medication for the different effect of the medication for when you take it at a different time, different dose, different frequency, different circumstances. Take note and have an open mind. Do not jump into conclusion. Just take note of all the effect and discuss with the doctor. Okay, and this information is very, very, very important for your doctor to help you to adjust the medication dose if needed. Yeah, so our job when we are medicating is to make notes like a scientist with a beginner's mind, with an open mind, okay? And then with the information, with the data, with the experience, okay, we share it with our doctors and they will help us to adjust the medication. If you're experiencing any side effect of medication, it's very, very important to put on a beginner's mind. Okay, to put on a beginner's mind. In my clinic, whenever my patient reports to me that there is any side effect, I often educate my patient or my clients that to consider three possibilities. Consider three possibilities whenever they are worried about certain effect or side effect. Okay? So this is usually what I tell the patient. So if we have an effect or the suspected side effect, for example, heart palpitation, okay, I say there are three possibilities. One possibility is it could be a side effect of medication, possible. It could be a side effect of medication, but it can also be the effect of the illness itself. For example, a person is suffering from anxiety attack or panic attack. So the heart palpitation could be a symptom of the illness itself, not necessarily is due to the medication. Okay, that's the second possibility, the effect of the illness itself, not the medication. Then the third thing, the effect, the heart palpitation could be due to other condition, other medical condition. For example, a thyroid hormone disorder. Thyroid hormone disorder is known to cause heart palpitation as well. So having an open mind, a beginner's mind to consider different possibilities is very, very important. Because if we don't have a beginner's mind, we'll jump to the conclusion that it's a side effect of the medication. It may or may not be. It's better to have an open mind, consider the possibilities, make notes, and then discuss with the doctor and allow the doctor to adjust the medication. So this is a very practical way to apply beginner's mind in the medicating experience. Okay, we have come to the last part. The last message I have on mindful medicating is related to wisdom. So mindful medicating cannot be separated from wisdom. So how do we apply wisdom in the medicating experience? Okay, wisdom says that acceptance of illness is very important. Acceptance of illness is very important. It's important for us to apply right effort to stay healthy physically and spiritually. Okay, one of the very important point that I would like to highlight under wisdom is, although I'm talking about mindful medicating, although I'm a doctor who prescribes medicine, it's also important to realize that medicine alone is not enough. Very often in treatment of any medical condition, very often medicine alone is not enough. Medicine is only part of the treatment plan. Very often, we also need to have a healthy lifestyle, like exercise. We need dietary modification. We need to have a positive mental attitude. We need to practice the Dharma. We need to meditate. So it's holistic. So in order to stay healthy, we need various causes and conditions. This is a Buddhist term that we always use. Everything happens because of causes and conditions. So when we are ill, there are also causes and conditions. We want to be healthy, there are also causes and conditions. So we need to take care of a lot of causes and conditions. Because one of the causes and conditions is to use medication mindfully. But it's only one of the causes and conditions. We need to take good care of the other causes and conditions as well. Yeah. So we need the wisdom to understand and accept this. I find these five healthy reflections that come from the Anguttara Nikaya Book of the Five very useful. Very useful to help us to accept and to remember the importance of taking good care of our health, to remember that everything in life is impermanent. We can fall sick, we can fall ill, we can age. Let me read to you that, I will explain to you. It's under the Anguttara Nikaya Book of the Five Bhikkhus. There are these five themes that should often be reflected upon by a woman or a man, by a householder or one gone forth, but five. I'm subject to old age, I'm not exempt from old age. I'm subject to illness, I'm not exempt from illness. I'm subject to death, I'm not exempt from death. I must be parted and separated from everyone and everything dear and agreeable to me. I'm the owner of my karma, the heir of my karma. Okay. Basically, it means life is impermanent, good health is impermanent. Life, everything is permanent. Life is impermanent, good health is impermanent. We can fall sick, we can age. Now that can be interpreted in a negative way, it can interpret it in a positive way. Okay, if you interpret in a negative way, that is not very helpful. If you think that, oh, we're going to be old, we're going to fall sick, we're going to die, there's nothing we can do about it, then that is a very miserable way of interpreting the teaching. However, if this is interpreted in a more positive and helpful way, that could be very useful. It's because life is impermanent. Health is also impermanent. Because it's impermanent, we should appreciate it better. For example, I'm grateful that I'm now relatively healthy. I don't need to be on any medications for long term. Of course, I do take medication enough for my nose allergy. I take medications for my gastric problem. I don't have to be on any long term medication. I'm grateful. Okay? But at the same time, I know that health is impermanent. I will age, I will fall sick one day. But because everything is impermanent, the way I look at it is I need to appreciate my health. Because it's impermanent, so I have to take good care of my health, I need to appreciate my health. So I will put in the right effort to take good care of my health. For example, for my physical health, I go for my badminton game every Saturday. Right? I do yoga, I do qigong breathing, I do meditation, I take care of my diet, I have a very sensitive stomach, I take care of my diet. Yeah. So I take good care of my health, I appreciate my health. Yeah. So I hope that every day we will try to reflect on these five things. I'm subjected to old age, sickness, death, impermanence. I'm the owner of my karma. So take actions. Karma is action. Take actions to stay healthy physically, mentally, and spiritually. Okay, I've come to the end of my sharing. So this is a summary. So the entire sharing is about mindful medicating. As I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, I hope none of you need to take medication. But if you have no choice, you need to be on a medication, this is how we can take our medications mindfully with the Buddhist principles. Yeah. So under the memory, we remind ourselves to take the medication according to the doctor's instruction. Remember the instruction to take medication. If you cannot remember, ask a friend to help you to remember or make notes or call your doctor or email your doctor or find out more on the instructions to take the medication. Use a pill box if necessary. Remember to take medication. Under the mindful attention is to pay full attention to the medicating process. So say in our heart, taking medication, I'm taking medication now. Okay? Pay full attention to the process of medication and also be aware of the mindset towards medication. Have a positive mental, positive mindset towards the medicine. Under kindness, it will radiate kind thoughts. Sing the Rasa Sayang song, soothe your heart, soothe the tummy, radiate grateful thoughts to everyone who have contributed to the medication, radiate kind thoughts to our mind, our body, to all other people who are on the same medication. Under beginner's mind is to monitor the medication effects or side effects with an open mind. Don't jump to the conclusion is a side effect. Have an open mind, take note of the effect and discuss with the doctor. And under wisdom is to reflect on the impermanence of health. Reflect on the impermanence of health and make holistic effort to stay healthy, physically, mentally, and spiritually. Okay, that's a summary of this talk. Yeah, you can, although this talk is on medication, you can apply the same principles when you're going for your COVID vaccination. I know some of you are not vaccinated yet. So when you're going for your vaccination, you can apply the same principles. So instead of calling it mindful medicating, we want to call it mindful vaccinating. Mindful vaccinating or mindful vaccination. Same principles. Under remembering is remembering. Remember your appointment for your vaccination. Okay. Remember to register for the vaccination. Remember what to bring and what you don't have to bring on the day of vaccination. Okay. Under attention. So when you're at the vaccination center, pay full attention to the vaccination process. Pay full attention. So make sure they give you the proper vaccine. Make sure there is actually the vaccine in the bottle. Check whether you have been vaccinated. And of course, have a positive mindset. Trust, believe that vaccination works. Okay. Then under kindness, when you're at the vaccination center, radiate kind thoughts. Radiate grateful thoughts, kind thoughts to the nurse who is giving you the vaccine. Radiate kind thoughts to all the other people who are at the vaccination center, wishing everyone safe, healthy, happy, free from side effects. Under the beginner's mind, so always have an open mind. If you feel uncomfortable, you have certain side effect, don't freak out, stay calm, don't jump into the conclusion it's a side effect. Don't jump into the conclusion side effect. If necessary, visit a doctor, discuss with your doctor, stay calm, stay cool. Okay. Of course, under wisdom, you reflect that everything in life is impermanent. Yeah. So besides the is impermanent, we need to take good care of our health. Vaccination is only one of the things to prevent the COVID infection. Besides vaccine, there are a lot of other things we need to do to stay healthy to prevent the COVID infection. Not just the vaccine itself. So it's important to have physical distancing, to wear masks, and take care of our general health. Yeah. So exactly the same. The mindful medicating principles, we can apply for mindful vaccination as well. Okay, with that, thank you very much. I hope you get some simple and practical ideas to apply mindfulness in the medicating process. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Your sharing is most timely and very practical. There are a few questions. There's one personal question from Patricia Sung. Dr. Phang, I also have a gastric issue at times. Can you share what gastric meds you are taking? Sadhu.
What gastric med I'm taking? Whatever I'm taking may be useful for me, may not be useful for you. But for Patricia Sung, okay, this is my sharing. Although I take gastric medication, but most of the time the gastric medication is not sufficient. I need to have other practice. I need to have rest. I need to have adequate sleep. Usually I will do my yoga stretching. I do my qigong breathing. I do my meditation plus the gastric medicine. That only works better. Anyway, the gastric medicine that I, one of the gastric medicine I take is Gaviscon. It's Gaviscon. I'm not selling Gaviscon, but the one I'm taking that suits me is Gaviscon. But I believe Gaviscon plus the other self-care method, qigong breathing, meditation, yoga, stretching, that it works better. If we just rely on medication, it'd be less effective.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Phang. Question from Sister Yen. Dr. Phang, can you please explain number 4, parted and separated? Forgot the whole sentence, thank you.
Which sentence? Please explain parted and separated.
The reflections, my reflections. Number 4, I'll be parted and separated from all that is near and dear to me.
Basically it's about impermanence, but it's impermanence in terms of relationship. Impermanence in terms of relationship. For example, I have a mom who is 72 years old. So it's reminding myself that my mom will fall sick. My mom will one day pass away. It's impermanence in terms of relationship. So if I were to apply that, then I have to remind myself, I'm with my mom. My mom is already old. She already have a lot of sickness. More sickness may come. One day, it's just a matter of time, she'll pass away. Again, of course, this has to be reflected in a healthy way. Not that, my mom is going to pass away. Oh, my mom is going to fall sick. That's very miserable. It should be, yes, my mom is going to fall sick, but at the moment, she's relatively healthy. I should appreciate my mom. I should appreciate whatever time left. Every moment, my mom cooks for me. My mom cooks for me for dinner. So every time I visit her for dinner, I always remind myself, this could be the last time. This could be the last time. She's not young anymore, 70 plus. This could be the last time. So when I remind myself to reflect on impermanence in relationship, it helps me to appreciate my relationship with my mom. Also to appreciate that I'm relatively healthy. My mom at the moment is also relatively healthy. Okay? Appreciate that. Of course, put in effort to maintain the good health. Yeah. As a response to Yanhua's second question. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's most relevant because a lot of old folks nowadays are just left staying on their own. So if we appreciate, then we make an effort to visit the old folks or parents more regularly.
Yeah.
Dr. Phang, can you elaborate further on the role of the psychosomatic illnesses on the attitude of the mind towards medicine?
Psychosomatic illness means any physical symptoms. Physical symptoms, which is not due to serious medical condition. For example, will be you're having chest pain, or heart palpitation, or chest discomfort. So there's a chest discomfort, but you go to the doctor, they say nothing wrong with your heart. There's no heart attack, there is no heart infection, but you're still feeling the symptom. So it's called psychosomatic illness. In fact, I used to joke that I have two types of patients. I have two types of patients which are most difficult to treat. Okay, the first type of patient are patients who don't think they are sick. Patients who don't think they are sick. They're actually sick, but they don't think they are sick. That is very difficult to treat. Then the second type of patient, actually they are not sick. They are not sick, they think they are sick. They are not sick, they think they are sick. And psychosomatic illness is one of those under the second category. So in psychosomatic illness, there's a lot of physical symptoms, a lot of physical discomfort, but it's not due to physical disease. It's due to emotional issues. So the feeling of chest pain, chest tightness, the feeling is real. It is not a delusion. It's not a hallucination. It's the mind didn't make it up. The sensation, the feeling is real, very, very, very real. But the reason is because the nerves are sensitive. And the reason the nerves are sensitive because of emotional issues, because of emotional or psychological issues. So therefore, my response is, if you really want to treat the psychosomatic symptoms, we need to address the emotional issues. You need to address my emotional issues. Okay. So what are your emotional issues is not possible to discuss over here. I suggest you find a good psychiatrist or good psychologist, a good counselor to deal with the emotional issues. But of course, if you're having it for the first time, you should go and check out with the doctor. But usually in psychosomatic illness, usually you've done a lot of doctor shopping. You go around to various doctors, clinic, hospital specialists, done all sorts of scans. They will say nothing wrong. But the feeling is very real, but the cause is due to emotional issues. So go get a therapist, go address the emotional issues, and then the physical symptoms will improve. That's all I can respond in this setting.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Dr. Phang, in the treatment of mental illnesses, what would be your recommendation in seeing a professional? Should we start with a counselor or a helpline and then proceed on to a psychologist and then finally only the psychiatrist? Or is there any particular sequence, just like seeing a GP and seeing a specialist?
Sometimes it's a bit difficult to decide whether to see a GP first or straight go to a psychiatrist or go to a counselor first or to go to a psychologist. Sometimes it's quite difficult to decide. I will try to give some guidelines, but the exact response will depend on the situation. But I'll try to give some simple guidelines. Okay. If you're very sure that your condition needs medication, go to a psychiatrist. For example, you're suffering from schizophrenia, which is a very severe brain condition with hallucination, delusion, hearing voices, seeing ghosts, believe that things enter the body, paranoid, violent, suicide. It is a brain disorder which requires medication. Then I will say, go straight to a psychiatrist, because that requires medication. Then you need to go to a psychiatrist. So you're very sure you need medication, then you go to a psychiatrist. Okay? If your intention is you just want to talk to somebody, you don't want any treatment, you don't want much of any opinion, you're just emotionally distressed, want to talk to somebody, you're very lonely, you just find somebody to talk to. In fact, not so much my advice, I just want to talk to somebody. I will suggest you go to a counselor, a registered counselor, either face-to-face or online. Like BGF is offering a phone counseling service. They just want to talk counselors. Okay? If you want slightly more than that, not just want to talk, but you want more intervention, more treatment, more therapy, like cognitive therapy, behavioral therapy. You want more treatment, but non-medication, you don't want any medication. You want more treatment, I'll suggest you look for a clinical psychologist. Clinical psychologist. Okay? And when do you go to a GP? A GP is a family doctor. Okay. I would say if you are not sure, especially if you're not sure whether you want to look for a psychiatrist or not, I think a good start is to look for a family doctor. Especially for senior citizens, you have a lot of medical conditions, Sometimes you're not sure whether it's due to medical condition or it's due to a psychological condition. I think best is to visit a family doctor first. So let them check the basic thing, check the sugar level, check the blood pressure, check the thyroid, because all these physical conditions can also affect the emotional condition as well. So in that context, I suggest go visit a family doctor first, and then let the family doctor decide whether you should be referred to a psychiatrist or to a psychologist or counselor, Yeah. If you are not sure, I'll suggest just go to anyone. If you're not sure, just go to anyone. And then they will get a little more information and then let you know. Can call BJ counseling unit, not sure. Just talk to them and then they will advise you accordingly on how to proceed.
Thank you, Dr. Pan, for very, very useful guidelines. Question from Lim Le Le. Doctor, is anxiety patient suitable to go hiking or serious exercise? Thanks.
I'm not sure how serious is serious. In this setting, we cannot clarify, elaborate, or get history. So I just have to respond based on my best guess. So in my clinic, this is a commonly asked question, usually in the context of when the person is exercising, a person with anxiety or panic attack is exercising, when you start to exercise, the anxiety symptoms will come. For example, the heart palpitation will come, the giddiness will come. Okay, usually it's asked in this context. Then my answer will be, yes, you should go ahead. The reason is, in people suffering from anxiety, the nervous system is too sensitive. So the nervous system overreacts. Actually, you go for exercise, you have a little bit of heart palpitation. Actually, there's no problem. You already checked with the doctor, there's no heart attack. You already seen the psychology or psychiatry. They say it's part of anxiety. So actually, what we should proceed, we should change the program. Because now, because of certain past experience, a person suffering from anxiety, the nervous system become oversensitive. It's overprotective. It's telling you to, hey, don't exercise. If you exercise, you may get heart attack. But all those are old programming, which is no longer useful. It might be useful at one time, but no longer useful. Things have changed. So therefore, we need to change the program. So the way to change the program is to continue to exercise, but do it gradually. Continue to exercise, do it gradually. The anxiety symptom, the psychosomatic symptom may come up, but it's okay. So we talk to yourself, it's okay. I already seen the doctor, I already talked to psychologist. They say it's okay to proceed. The symptoms will come up, but it will come and go. It will come and go. Slowly, gradually, we reprogram the system saying that, oh, actually it's safe now. Actually, it's safe now. Then after some time, the symptom will disappear. So in short, should proceed, but do it gradually. That should be the way. And this is very, very important. You have to get this very clear, because very often my patient, they will have this thinking. So if I exercise, I have this symptom, does that mean that there is more damage? It makes sense? It can be very worrying, you know, if you exercise and you get the symptom. What does the symptom mean? Does the symptom mean there is ongoing damage, or the symptom actually just reminding me to be more cautious? I repeat, it's very important. Now, this is cognitive therapy, you know. So you go for exercise, you're having anxiety, you go for exercise, you have certain symptoms like chest tightness. The symptom, what is the message? Is it telling us to stop to exercise because there'll be ongoing damage to the heart? Or is it just reminding us to be cautious? Please proceed, but be cautious. Which one is correct? It should be the second one, not the first one. There is no ongoing physical damage to the heart, no damage. It's just the nervous system is oversensitive. It's just reminding us, be careful, be mindful. Please proceed with your exercise. It is healthy, but do it slowly. That's very, very important. Okay.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Phang. For those who are listening in from Facebook, kindly keep your questions coming in, because Dr. Phang still can entertain another 10, 15 minutes of questions. So it is very rare to get Dr. Phang to share with us. Please keep your questions coming in. Okay, another question, Dr. Phang. Depression is the opposite side of anxiety, right? Would the same advice apply to a depression person? A person who is depressed will being exposed to nature walks, hiking in the forest help him?
Yes, definitely. Same thing apply. We need to have the wisdom and understanding. one of the common symptoms for people with depression is tiredness, physically tired, very, very tired. I won't say just physical, but it's a physical tiredness plus emotional tiredness, mind, body tiredness. Okay? Of course, everyone knows that exercise is good. Everyone knows that doing mindful walking in the nature is good. But when we start doing it, there might be some conflict. For example, I'm very tired, physically tired, emotionally tired. So if I go for a walk, I go for exercise, am I going to be more tired? So the important thing is the tiredness. How do we relate to the tiredness? The tiredness is a symptom. How do we relate to the tiredness? Of course, we can apply those principles. Attention, beginner's mind, wisdom, kindness, same thing. Okay? So the helpful way of relating to a tiredness is we need to understand that actually in depression, the more we rest, the more tired we become. The more we rest, the more tired we become. The more we work, the more we exercise, the more we keep ourselves busy, the tiredness will disappear. But usually the beginning part, which is difficult, the starting the engine part, which is the most difficult. So if we have the right understanding, that will be slightly easier. At least we won't have this wrong view that, oh, if I force myself, I'm going to cause any damage to the body. No, we're not going to cause any damage to the body. In fact, not exercising, giving in, just rest and sleep more, is going to cause more damage emotionally in long term. Yeah, so we should push ourselves with kindness, with gentleness, with understanding, with wisdom. Yeah, same thing applies.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. No questions from Facebook. Dr. Phang, I can give some advice on people having sleep problems. How to have better sleep? I believe a lot of people are suffering from this problem.
For sleep problem, actually, I written an article which I published in the MindfulGym website on how to sleep mindfully. So in that webpage, I compile a lot of information. I also compile a lot of exercises. To help people with insomnia. So I have a YouTube playlist as well. There's a MindfulGym YouTube playlist. There's also a MindfulGym blog. There's an extensive article. Long article I written on the insomnia. I can give you the link later. Hey, since this topic is about mindful medicating, I would like to touch on the medication and sleep. Insomnia. Of course, as I mentioned repeatedly, I hope you don't need to be on medication. Specifically in relating to your question, I hope you don't need to be on medication for your insomnia problem. I really hope you don't have to. But having said that, see, I'm a Buddhist. So I tend to attract patients who are Buddhist. It's not uncommon that I see clients in my clinic. They will typically tell me, I tried various methods. I tried yoga, I tried qigong, I tried meditation, I tried metta, I tried the diet, tried supplement, I tried everything. They don't work. So it's also quite common. And usually I won't tell them to try harder. Usually I won't tell them to try harder. You know why? Because if I tell them to try harder, they may feel very guilty. Because those who come to me, they have really tried everything. So they will feel very bad, they will feel very guilty. So usually I will acknowledge your frustration. Okay. What I'm trying to say, my main point is it's okay to try some medication mindfully. It's okay to try some medication mindfully for your insomnia. Mindfully means apply all those principles that I mentioned earlier. If possible, no need to take. If you need to take, you apply all the principles. Then we can have a thorough discussion what kind of medication is safe for long term, what kind of medication is not safe for long term. Okay? And hopefully we only need to take for short term. And usually in my experience, when the insomnia is very severe, you still need medication for a short period. When the insomnia is very severe, you still need medication for a short period, followed by all the non-medication methods, which I already mentioned in the, which I've compiled and published in the MINDFULGym YouTube channel and the MINDFULGym blog. Yeah. So to me, this is the, is a holistic way. Holistic way. But it's very severe medication, mindful medication for insomnia. After some time, you're a bit better, then you use all the non-medication method. Like mindful body stretching, mindful breathing, body scan, loving kindness meditation. All those are very, 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 very useful. I teach all those things as well. But when it's very severe, a lot of us are having very severe, so very severe, because it's a damage to the body's biology. The biology, the hormones are all affected. You need medication for a short period just to regulate back all the hormones and all the chemicals. Then we proceed with all the non-medication methods. Middle way, to me, this is my way of middle way.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Yeah, for the information of all the viewers, this video will be posted on YouTube, and the link to the sleep article by Dr. Phang will be posted in the YouTube description also. So next question by Patricia Sung. Dr. Phang, will attending your MINDFULGym program be an alternative to seeing a psychologist for poor mental health, like very negative thoughts, fearful thoughts, etc.?
I would say is a good way to complement the treatment. I wouldn't say it to replace alternative. Actually, also depends on your condition, because I don't know what is your condition. Generally, the MINDFULGym program, the one I mentioned earlier, is for general stress reduction and healthy living. The one that I run online in Zoom, in BGF, and the one in MINDFULGym is for general stress reduction, general health and healing. But if you want to apply it in clinical condition, I mean things like severe depression, panic disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, or trauma, my experience usually is not sufficient. That's my experience. Usually is not sufficient. The MINDFULGym method need to be combined with other methods that we use in therapy, like cognitive behavioral therapy and other types of therapy. So I do not know of your condition, so I cannot comment specifically, but I suppose you can just try for a start. All the resources are free online, BGF website, MINDFULGym website, BMHA website. You try it, okay? It works for you, very good. If it doesn't work, don't be disappointed, because it's also quite common if you're suffering from clinical condition, the general mindfulness may not be good enough. You need more clinical mindfulness. That's a term that I used recently. I created these three terms. Buddhist mindfulness or spiritual mindfulness. Then you have the circular mindfulness, not non-religious, for general stress management. Then also there's a thing called clinical mindfulness. Clinical mindfulness is for clinical condition, for certain sickness like anxiety, panic disorder, depression. So mindfulness is used in all the three conditions, but the purpose is different. Spiritual mindfulness is for spiritual enlightenment. Circular mindfulness is for general stress reduction and wellness. Clinical mindfulness is very specific to treat certain clinical conditions. Very often, you need other form of expertise and other form of therapy. Okay? And then give a try. Just give a try first. The resources are free.
Next question. From Ricote, how to apply placebo mindset when one doesn't like medicine? How to apply placebo mindset?
Good question. Okay, a few things you can consider. First of all, maybe don't call it medicine. we can call it a pill. Because our perception, this is a bit of psycholinguistic. Our perceptions of words, all of us have different perceptions of words. You know? So instead of using the word medicine, maybe you can use the word pill. Some people have more positive perceptions of the word pill, P-I-L-L, pill, than medicine. And worse still, some people use the word drug. You know? The word drug, the word medicine, and the word pill. So you should ask yourself when you hear these three words, medicine, drug, and pill, what is your perception? So choose the word that you have the most positive perception. In my clinic, I try to avoid using the word drug, because the word drug has very negative connotation. It associates with drug addicts, drug abuse, dependence, addiction. I prefer to use the word medicine. Sometimes I use the word pill. If you are Chinese speaking, you may want to explore using different words to describe medicine. For example, in Chinese, there's another word called in Cantonese, most probably in Cantonese, there's a word called tan, tan, yun or tan. So you ask yourself, yo, Cantonese, that is for those who are Cantonese speaking, yo, yun and tan, yo, yun and tan, which one sounds more positive to you? It's something for you to explore. So basically, you try to use the term which is more appealing to you, more positive, more healthy to you. That's one way. Second way is, before you take the medicine, it's good to find a good doctor who can explain to you the rationale of taking the medicine. The rationale of taking medicine, how it works. I believe with better understanding, we will have a better mindset. I mean, seriously, if I'm on medication, if I need to be on long-term medication, I need to understand what is the purpose of the medicine. I need to know how the medicine works. I need to know how the medicine can be used together with yoga, qigong, meditation in a holistic way. So I believe finding out about all these things, how the medicine works, what is the mechanism action, what is the purpose, how I can combine with other treatment methods, I believe that will change the mindset towards medicine.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Next question by Tan Quan. Dr. Phang, why do depression people always deny that they are having that sickness?
Good question. There are several possibilities. Again, the exact answer, the exact reason you have to discuss with your doctor or therapist. But the possible reasons are possible reasons. Okay. So imagine I'm having depression, but I deny. I don't want to seek help, I deny. So what are the possible reasons? Okay. First of all, the first reason is I do not know it's depression. I don't have the advantage of depression. For example, I'm lazy. I'm just lazy. Not knowing that actually laziness or no energy, exhaustion, emotional and physical exhaustion is actually a symptom of depression. So not knowing it, lack of awareness, thinking it's just lazy. I'm lazy. I'm lazy. I'm not having depression. So that could be one reason. So there is no awareness or no understanding that the person is suffering from depression. That is one. Okay. And another common one is sometimes it's not denial of the illness. It's just that the person is refused to seek help because of certain things. You don't know where to seek help or because it's cause reason. It's not really denying the illness. It's more of a denying the process of seeking treatment. That's also one possibility. Another very common one is very often depression is due to a lot of relationship and family issues. Depression is just a label when you have certain symptoms, irrespective of the cause. And so one of the common reason for depression is family or relationship issue. When it comes to family or relationship issue causing depression, it's a bit complicated. I'll give you an example of how it can be complicated. For example, let's say Bobby, your wife is having depression. Okay, let's say your wife is having depression. Just for discussion sake only, it's not. And the reason she's depressed because you're fooling around. because you're having an affair, you're fooling around. Okay, and then your wife is depressed. Okay, and you tell your wife you're depressed, you're going to see Dr. Phang. Do you think she'll be willing to go and seek help for her depression? She will likely be thinking, you are the one causing me depressed. You are the one fooling around and causing me depression. And now you're telling me to go and see Dr. Phang to take medication. No way. Got it? So these are given you three reasons. Of course, there are other reasons as well. So if you want to really troubleshoot the reasons, you want to troubleshoot the problem, you need to actually listen. That's why in BGF counseling training, we train people to listen. Listen and find out what are the underlying reasons. Listen for the reasons, and then we troubleshoot according to the reasons. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Next question from Lian Hua. I'm very anxious when any incidents arise. Then my body feels cold and nervous. Am I suffering from any sickness?
Not sickness, anxiety. Suffering from anxiety. Anxiety may not be a sickness. All of us experience some form of anxiety. So feeling nervous, feeling cold, usually anxiety symptom. Anxiety symptom is a normal thing. All of us has some form of anxiety. Anxiety is only problematic if it interferes with your life. If your anxiety is so bad until you cannot sleep and then you get all sorts of sickness, then it's a problem. Your anxiety is so bad until you cannot work, frequent MC, always get sick, it's a problem. Your anxiety is so bad until you cannot study, to take an intermission from study, that is a problem. If your anxiety is just a bit of discomfort, it comes and go, that is not, it's not really an illness, it's not a sickness, but it's still a problem. It's still a problem. So that one can, if it's not so serious, you can try the MINDFULGym program. In the MINDFULGym program, if you go to the MINDFULGym website, I have various versions. If you are not the so hardworking one, you want a simple one, I delete one, I think 2 years ago. So that was edited. Its total duration is 2 hours in seven episodes in the MINDFULGym YouTube channel. It's 2 hours MINDFULGym training. If you're very motivated, I've got another one, 8 hours in total. So you choose which one you like. I suggest you start with the 1-2 hours. So those some exercises are very useful for normal anxiety issues. It also depends on what kind of incident. Because you mentioned it, incident, we're not sure what kind of incident. If it's related to public speaking, I suggest you join the BGF effective speaking course. If it's related to presentation or public speaking, highly recommended BGF effective speaking course. It's more emotional, then you go for the MINDFULGym, the 2 hours kindfulgym program. Not necessary illness, but anxiety symptoms.
Thank you, Dr. Phang. Next question on sleep. I'm having anxiety and sleep disorder. I'm on medications on and off. Now I'm looking for alternatives other than medication. Example, essential oils and yoga. Is it considered medication using essential oils? How can I be mindful in this case?
Essential oil is not medication. Essential oil is not medication. So straightforward, essential oil is not. Some of you might have tried melatonin. Melatonin is available in some retail pharmacy. Melatonin. To me, melatonin is also not medication. So essential oil is not medication. Melatonin is not medication. Looking for alternative. Let me see what is the exact question. Is essential oil a medication? No, it's not. How can I be mindful in this case? I'm not sure mindful or what. If you mean mindful or what are the other non-medication options, then I will suggest you go to the MINDFULGym blog because there's an extensive compilation of all the non-medication method. All the non-medication method, sleep hygiene, relaxation, body scan, loving kindness meditation, adjusting your the mattress, adjusting the environment, even some energy method, all are there on the MindfulGym webpage. So I'm not sure which one you have tried, which one you have not tried. You may want to visit the page and see which one you have not tried, you want to give a try. But as I mentioned, typically those who come to my clinic, you know, in the Malaysian setting, people don't, there's a stigma, there's a stigma associated with seeing psychiatrists. So most people, when by the time they come to my clinic, usually they are very severe. The insomnia is usually very severe. Seeing a psychiatrist is last option, usually the last option in the Malaysian context. So in that context, as I mentioned, they will try everything. They'll try essential oil, yoga, they'll try melatonin, they'll try all the supplements, they'll try everything. Then my suggestion is, you want to consider medication, but even medication, you already mentioned on medication. So medication is also an art. There are many, many types of medication, and the attitude is using the medication, and also the art of combining medication. I don't know what medication you're on. Art of combining the medication, and also the art of combining medication with all the non-medication method. So I'm not sure what mindfulness you're talking about, but based on my clinic, my experience in my clinic, I think most people are not mindful or not aware that that is a role of medication. Medication may not be bad all the time. It's how you use it. Just like fire can be harmful. Water can be helpful, can be harmful. A knife can be helpful, can also be harmful. The same goes for medication for sleep. It can be helpful, it can be harmful, depending on how you use that. So that's one of the common things people are not mindful or not aware of. So that's what I'm going to highlight. The other thing is one more thing that most people are not aware of, that is the art of combining medication. How to combine the medication and how to combine medication and the non-medication method. It's also an area that most people are not aware of. So the person who's asking this question, you may want to explore how to combine medication and non-medication. And if you're still on medication, how to combine the various medication.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Phang. It's now 11:30. Do you mind taking another two questions?
Okay, no problem.
Okay, next question from Yang King. Sometimes I take calms from the pharmacy containing L-ornithine and L-theanine to ensure good rest. Is the pill good? I wonder how this thing works.
In my clinic, I try to avoid using the word good or bad. I try to avoid, in therapy and clinic, I try to avoid using the word good and bad because that can trigger a lot of rumination, you know, what is good, what is bad. So a better question will be, is it helpful or not helpful? Is it helpful or not helpful? So if it works for you, that is good and helpful. If it works for you, go ahead, no problem. I heard of that. Yeah. For some people, they find it helpful, then by all means, go ahead. No problem. But as I say, most of the time in my clinic, in my setting, in my clinic, the insomnia and the anxiety that I attend to, they are very severe. Because by nature, because I'm a psychiatrist, the nature of my practice, the insomnia and anxiety are very severe. Usually calms doesn't work. Usually. But it's different from saying that calm is not useful. So you ask yourself whether it's useful or not. If it's useful, by all means, go ahead. Not really patient, maybe friends or relative. They find it useful, then go ahead. Maybe one important information. This is my experience. If you go to a retail pharmacy, there are all sorts of products for sleep. All sorts of products. Okay, my experience is of all the products, my experience is melatonin is the strongest for sleep. Please don't get me wrong, I'm not selling melatonin, I'm not promoting any particular product or any pharmacy, but my experience is of all the products for sleep, melatonin is the strongest. It's only available in certain retail pharmacy. Okay, if melatonin doesn't work, usually I say forget about all the rest. There are a lot more. There are a lot more. If melatonin doesn't work, forget about the rest. Melatonin doesn't work, forget about the rest. Then your next step, usually, as I say, Malaysia rarely you go straight to a psychiatrist. If melatonin doesn't work, go seek help from a family doctor. Go seek help from a family doctor or a GP. And usually they will give you a little bit of a sleeping pill, calming pill, sleeping pill, calming pill. So if your condition is mild, you take it for about a week, then you're better. Then if you're not getting better, the family doctor will refer you to a psychiatrist like me. So generally for treatment for insomnia, that is the various stages. Okay, the first one is try MindfulGym online. Do all the relaxation method, try yoga, qigong, take melatonin, calm. Okay. If that doesn't work, if melatonin doesn't work, other doesn't work, then you go and look for a family doctor. Usually they give you the sleeping pill or the calming medicine for 1 week like that. If it doesn't work, then you visit, get a good psychiatrist. You get a good psychiatrist, the initial phase is medication, so stabilize. Then you revisit all the other methods, essential oil, meditation, yoga, qigong. And when once stabilized, then you go back to those methods. Because for long term, no medication. Long term is you use all those methods. But when the body is a very, very stressed out state, those methods don't work. So we need medication first, followed by all those non-medication methods. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Park. Last question from Chia Chi Man. In terms of COVID-19, when people are stuck at home, does prolonged loneliness leads to depression? And what is your advice?
Yes, definitely. Yeah, MCO, physical isolation, is a risk factor for depression, definitely. More and more people are experiencing insomnia, anxiety, depression. Yeah. So my clinic, full of patients with COVID-related insomnia, anxiety, depression, loneliness. Yeah, definitely. My advice is to, even if at home, even if you're not going out, try to maintain a routine at home. Try to maintain a routine at home. Try to stay active physically and try to maintain social connection. Physically, we can't go out, but we can still be connected. Like now we are connected. I'm not in BGS, but I'm not at your house, but we are still socially connected. So even if you're at home, try to maintain a routine, do things, stay active, stay socially connected. And if you are still lonely, you can call BGF. Maybe Bobby afterwards, you can advertise BGF counseling unit. You need to talk to somebody, you can call BGF counseling line, and you can talk to somebody.
That's the last question. Thank you, Dr. Phang. Very practical sharing, and as you can see, lots of people have a lot of interest in sleep. Maybe you can consider our next topic on sleep.
On sleep, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So once again, thank you, Dr. Phang. Thank you for everyone who has tuned in. And let us end with a short sharing on merits and making aspirations.